What's up, everyone? My name is K-Rad. I'm a rapper, producer, beer lover, and now I'm a podcaster. Podcasting about Northwest hip-hop and Northwest beer. Why? Well, I love them both, and frankly, you should too. So sit back and crack a cold one as a weekly guest and I talk about all things hip-hop and hops. This is Hoppy on Broadway. Welcome to episode one of Hoppy on Broadway, the first episode of hopefully many. I started this podcast mainly to promote the underground Seattle hip-hop scene, but also to connect with those who are involved with the culture over a few local beers, be it a rapper and an IPA, a producer and a stout, a promoter and a pale, etc., etc., whatever, really. We're here to open a dialogue, but also to have fun. Before anyone asks, which I'm sure will happen, the show's title is an allusion to Sir Mix-a-Lot's hit Posse on Broadway, which was one of the first Seattle singles in the hip-hop culture to come out of the Northwest, and I thought it'd be a fun little homage to it. Today on the show is Wizdumb, and you'll be hearing some of his tracks throughout the show from his soon-to-be-released album. Here's a preview of the first track on Shadows.
You go ahead and do that, all right?
This stuff can give you brain damage.
Yo, suckers know my name. Suckers' mouths is running. Suckers only want to hang when they low on money. It's funny, because suckers in my town be acting crummy. Only want to throw smoke, just a bunch of lungies. And these young G's don't seem to understand. The instrumental rap gonna cost some dividends. I'm listening, and still ain't nothing hitting in. Oh, you're magnificent, sounding like some impotent. Sucker with a cactus in his ass, I need some practice. Illiterate sucker in urgent need of geriatrics. Yo, here, come take a dose of rapper prophylactics. I got them on special along with teddy bears and ass kicks. Suckers, suckers like to talk a lot of nothing. My name is in these suckers' mouths when they want something.
Alex Hupp, aka Wizdumb the Wax Molesta, is on the show today. He's a Seattle lo-fi beatmaker, DJ, producer, rapper, recording engineer, and did I forget anything else?
Frog enthusiast.
Frog enthusiast, that's right. I think I saw maybe on like an old Facebook post or something that you have tree frogs.
Yeah, I got three Australian tree frogs.
What made you want to get tree frogs?
I don't know, I just, I guess I, I grew up around all these, my dad used to have all these crazy pets when I was a kid, and I kind of just grew up around reptiles and all this wacky stuff. And also like, the current living situation I got doesn't allow me to have cats or a dog, so I went with frogs.
That's actually awesome. Are they easy to take care of?
Yeah, pretty easy.
I feel like they'd be pretty chilly.
Yeah, they're almost easier than a dog or a cat, actually, to be honest. They really don't do much.
Well, that's important. Water. Yeah, especially when you can be locked in like the zone and making your bees forever, right? Yeah. Well, we're going to kick this off. We're going to start out. Today, we're drinking beer from Silver City Brewery, and we're going to start out with the Tropic Haze IPA. Have you ever had any of these beers before?
I've had some Silver City beers before, yeah.
Yeah, they're based out of Bremerton. They're really good. What I love about the Tropic Haze is that they have it marked incorrectly at QFC down the street. So I got a six-pack for $4.50.
Nice.
Yeah, so it's absolutely... it's a delicious beer as well, so I'm going to pour us up. Keep in mind, I'm spilling everywhere, that's okay. Keep in mind that these are tasters, but if you want more beer, we have a lot more beer in the fridge. Drink however much you'd like.
Right on, man.
Party. That's what I'm saying, it's a Sunday. It's 6.4% with 50 IBU. The hops are classified, but the malts are Northwest Pale, British Pale, Flaked Wheat, and Rolled Oats. They describe this as a seemingly magical reaction between a specialized yeast strain, oats, wheat, and an experimental hop variety results in a blossom of wondrous tropical fruit flavor. Without further ado, cheers.
Cheers.
Beer.
Oh, it's damn good.
Yeah, it is pretty good.
You like it?
Yeah.
Me and my friends always rave about this beer. It is really kind of tropical. It's kind of juicy, but it's a nice IPA. I love IPAs.
Me too. It's got the hops taste, but it's also a little bit refreshing too.
Yeah. Feel free to pour some more if you want more.
I like the can design too.
Yeah, what's really nice about these...
The Miami Vice look.
Yeah, that and the matte finish on it, I think is pretty neat.
Dope.
But what I want to talk to you right now about is your music, of course.
Yeah, man.
You're going to have a new album coming out. We're going to talk about that later.
Yep.
But first, I want to talk about how I met you, which was a week and a half ago at the Bop Alloy concert at the Crocodile.
Crocodile Back Bar.
Yeah. So tell me about how you know Bop Alloy and how you got to open for them.
Well, I met Marcus D through my man Leland Jones, who is my studio partner. We own and operate a recording studio down in SODO at the Bemis Building. And I had already heard of Marcus D's music online before, and I didn't even know he was from Seattle. But my buddy Leland was like, yo, my boy Marcus D's coming through. He wants to buy some records, and he wants to just come chill. And he kind of wanted to learn how to use the MPC a little bit, because he had just got one, and he was like switching from like computer setup
to analog
setup. And that was probably about 2 years ago I met Marcus.
Okay.
And then we kind of hit it off, man. And then he ended up moving to Japan. And then whenever he comes back, like, he brings me back a big fat stack of Japanese records, and I buy records from him, or we trade.
Well, I heard in an interview back from 2012 that you have over 4,000 vinyls.
I did. I had up to like 6 or 7 at one point, but I just sold about 3,000 to my buddy Zach, who also knows Marcus really well too. And now I just got about 3,000.
3,000? I still think that's more than enough to work with.
It's more than enough, yeah.
Yeah, so talk to me about that. When you get into sampling, it's a bit of a, I don't want to say it's a lost art in hip-hop, because people still do it, but the analog technology using the MPC and the other samplers isn't used as much. So what drives you to keep on this golden era hip-hop path?
Well, I guess that's kind of how I learned how to do it in the first place. Like, I learned on analog gear. I learned how to use the SP-404 or the SAM. I was using a 202 and a 303 at first.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that was just, you know, working in the box was just kind of how I learned, and it was kind of how my brain worked. I was kind of like, I kind of got into the game just before the laptop thing kind of took over.
Mm-hmm.
I remember like the first time I even saw somebody using a laptop to do production was, I saw Square Pusher at Chop Suey like probably 11 years ago or something like that. And I'd never seen that before. He was using like a MIDI controller and mm-hmm. like a laptop, and like, it was crazy.
So what does that look like for you? If you're gonna start off a beat, square one would probably be finding the sample, right?
Yeah, I was just going, I buy a lot of records, and then I was going to listen through them and shop, you know, find samples. When I first started out, I was sampling a lot of jazz. I still sample a lot of jazz, but when I was first starting out, I was sampling a lot of old jazz, dollar bin jazz stuff I was mm-hmm. finding, and then I'd find drum breaks, or I had this TR, it wasn't a TR-808, it was a Boss Dr. Rhythm, mm-hmm. like, fake 808 drum machine. It had drum sounds in it, and I would just sample drums from that, and I'd just loop jazz loops from these records. I didn't know how to chop beats yet. I was just looping them, and then playing drum patterns to them, and then, like, resampling on the MPC, or the SP. I didn't know how to use the sequencer.
That's the Roland SP, right?
Yeah, Roland SP.
So I'm a little confused, because I'm not a very big analog guy.
Yeah.
I do most of my production on the computer. How does an MPC basically chops up a sample, so you can put them on pads and play them, right?
MPC is pretty much a sampling sequencing rhythm machine, where you can like record any input source in, and you can arrange it in a sequence. You can chop it into pieces, or you could loop it or whatever, but it's a sampler workstation, I guess. It's like I'll take samples and I'll cut them up into pieces, and I'll map them across the pads and different chop points or whatever, and then like I'll have my drums at the bottom, or I'll have my drums on the next bank of samples. And then you got like the sequencer. It's just like a, it's not like a step sequencer, but it has a metronome on it, and mm-hmm. you can turn quantization on and off or whatever, you know, just build beats, and you just have like layers. It's like you do graphic design, you use Photoshop. It's like
right.
having layers. You have your kick on one layer, your hi-hat on one layer, your snare on one layer.
Yeah.
Sample, and then you can just go into the track mute screen, and you can turn them on and off like you're turning a layer on and off.
Yeah, and play live. And then, you know, as a rapper, you make this beat, you lay it all out. Are you recording? Do you output your beat onto like Pro Tools and then record on Pro Tools or something like that?
It's funny. I just started recording on a computer probably a year and a half, 2 years ago. Before that, I was just using I had a Tascam multi-track and a Roland VS880 multi-track, and I have a half-inch reel-to-reel tape machine that I was using, and that was it.
Wow,
just all analog.
You're straight up lo-fi.
Yeah. I always that's how I learned how to do it, and that's how I like. I guess that's how I developed my sound. A lot of people ask me like, how did you get that effect or that texture on all your music? And I was like, I was just using all this analog gear.
Yeah, because you also dropped some of your releases on tape.
Yep. Yeah, my buddy Dan and I, we own and operate a little mini tape label called Low Fidelity Records, and we put out cassettes.
And you guys have been doing that since 2012, right?
Yep. Yeah.
Yeah. So I was wondering if you helped create Low Fly, and apparently that's true.
It was originally my idea. I just wanted to have like a resource for like me and the homies, like my close homies that I worked with, to have like a way to put out music without like losing money on it, pretty much. Like, it wasn't really, we weren't trying to like get people to sign with us or anything. We're just like four or five artists that we just pooled our money together, and the money that we made from those tapes, we would just put it back into the next release. Mm-hmm. That was kind of the original idea, and then it kind of took off a little bit more than that, and we got like, my buddy and I, we did a Kickstarter, and we got like, we raised enough money to buy all the tape duplicators and stuff, and like I designed all the graphic. I didn't want to school for graphic design. I did all the graphic stuff, and and we got our LLC, and we just did it.
Hell yeah. That's great, and you guys are still doing it today, right?
Yeah. We still do it. It's a little bit, it's kind of slowed down a little bit. We've put out 10 releases, so.
Okay.
Yeah.
And is this any way related to Funky Pie Productions?
Funky Pie Productions was just the name that I released stuff under before I was signed to anybody. I used to be signed to Lurk Music before Low Fly, and then they kind of went under, but before that it was Funky Pie. It was just like a name I went by.
Yeah
It's like when Doom put shit out under Nature Sounds or whatever.
yeah exactly. Yeah, you're a big Doom fan as well, right?
Yeah
Doom, Hieroglyphics, Wu-Tang Clan.
Wu's cool.
What like, out of all those, who really inspired you to start, you know?
Definitely Doom has been a big influence on me, lyrically, and probably, like, you know, like, all the crazy, like, I always admired his use of, like, movie samples and, like, just how you'd take all these crazy little vocal blips and make all these little montages of I don't know, just, like, cartoonish dialogue, mm-hmm. and make like a story out of it. I thought that was cool because I grew up watching old movies with my dad, old B movies, and reading comic books and all that stuff. So I always thought that was, I guess that kind of appealed to me.
Definitely, because MF Doom is all about, he portrays himself as, you know, a comic. He's based off of the Doom from Fantastic Four.
Yeah.
He wears that mask, but he also, in a lot of his album artwork, is portrayed as a comic book character, which is really cool. And he's still, you know, obviously a big legend in the hip hop world.
Yeah, it's cool, man. Yeah, he's definitely one of my biggest influences.
Yeah. Well, one thing that I draw a parallel between you and him is not just obviously the lo-fi sampling and layering of things like that nature, but he also does a lot of duos and groups that he kind of just fuses and releases under a lot of different names.
Yeah.
That's something I see with you, because you're not just Wizdumb, you're half of G-Wiz, you're a third of the Smoking Agents, and you're half of Cheddar Dust, which I believe came out a long time ago, right?
A long time ago. Cheddar Dust was... me and my buddy Mad Shroom from Black Magic Noise, who are really, they're a real famous group out here. They're great. And I was living up in Everett for a couple years, my high school years, and with my dad. And I didn't really know anybody who was doing music up there, and I felt kind of like out of place. And then I met those guys, and they kind of took me under their radar and put me on out there. And we became good friends. But yeah, me and Matchroom did that album, Cheddar Dust. And there's a funny story behind that. He came into my room one time and there was like a Cheez-It box. It was just like, it was like the bag inside the Cheez-It box. It was just sitting on the my table or something, and there was like just the cheese salt at the bottom, the leftovers. And he goes, I'm having this like serious conversation with him, like, I think my girl just broke up with me and I was just like all bummed out and shit. And I'm like talking to him and he goes, yo man, yo, hold that thought. He goes, yo, you gonna finish that? I'm like, what, the cheddar dust me? And we just kind of, from that, we just both started cracking up and we ended up using that. And then our alter egos in there was, he went by Harvey Dill and I went by Gouda Smoke.
Nice.
And all the songs are cheese related. It's pretty goofy.
You did a lot of collaborating on your last LP, Mostly Crew.
Mm-hmm.
And there was one track that you spotted on my notepad earlier, the song Commercial with Blowfly.
Yeah, no, story about Blowfly is I've always been a big fan of his work pre-Blowfly, because his name's Clarence Reed, and he was like this amazing soul singer and ghostwriter for all these amazing soul musicians, and he helped start the record label Alston Records in Miami, Florida, back in like the early 1960s, and he like wrote like all the hits for like KC and the Sunshine Band and Betty Wright and Timmy Thomas and Gwen McRae, and like this, all this amazing stuff that a lot of people don't know about. And anyways, he started doing the Blowfly thing. He got famous for that. And when he'd come to town, I'd go to all his shows, and his manager and I ended up becoming friends. And whenever he'd come to town, he'd stay with me or we'd go eat together. And he ended up doing a drop on my record, and I produced a couple songs on his last album before he died. And he actually put me in his will when he died.
Really?
He left me like this huge box of 45s, like from the Alston record catalog that never got played or whatever.
It's always nice to go out to those, in my opinion, the smaller shows, even if the person isn't like Blowfly wasn't as big at the time.
Yeah.
Because it's such an intimate venue, and you really get to see what it's like up close and personal for that artist. And then for your sake, you got to meet the manager and actually collaborate with this guy who's a very prophetic writer.
Yeah, it's crazy. It's kind of surreal, man. I was like, damn, like, I'm actually like building with this dude.
Yeah.
Crazy.
That is crazy. Well, we're gonna take a break pretty soon, but first, something that I personally really want to know about is what keeps you solidified in this golden age type of sound.
I don't know, man. I guess I'm an old school sap or something. I was, you know, old soul. Like I grew up listening to all the 90s rap stuff, and it just, there's something so magical about it to me, because I feel like it was like a once in the universe kind of thing. Same with jazz. Like, I don't think that there's always going to be jazz music and always going to be hip-hop music, but I don't think it's ever going to sound the same as it did when it was in its prime, because, like, you know, the technology's different now, and like I feel like it really was like hip-hop was really kind of the start of something new in music, like, you know, and I think that's when people were really innovating back then, and it was just so, there's just so much going on at once, and so many different styles of just like the same type of music. It was just kind of crazy. But I don't know, I'm tired of all, I don't like any of this new stuff that's coming out, and it drives me nuts, and I feel like if nobody's gonna make this music that I wanna listen to, then my friends and I need to do it.
Yo, hold on that magic cabbage, connect the cameras, radiate the mind power used to my advantage. The plan is to nab some ends off my standards, Willie Bamis while I'm kissing on these stanzas. George Costanza, chilling in the mansion, flying with gold stanchions and ladies necromancing, or maybe dancing, shit I don't know, saying all this shit hoping for a pot of gold. But I get particles and bougie articles, scrubbing down the yacht for my people in my nauticals. Ayo, I gotta go, find myself a probable methodical. comical, unstoppable, astronomical comet flow. This is a throwaway rap. I say that every time over kicks and hand claps. I do it for myself. I do it to stay true. I do it for Herb, Paul, C, and J, too. I do it for my people on the corner or the block. I do it for the sake and the art of hip hop. I do it for the love, the daps, and lip drop. I never really did it till I learned to wreck shop.
The next beer we're going to drink is the Ridgetop Red Ale, also from Silver City Brewing. It's 6% and a little less bitter than the Tropic Haze we had just prior. It's with 15 IBU. It's described as a full-bodied and smooth with a sweet caramel flavor balanced with Northwest Liberty hops for a refreshing finish. Let's try this out, eh?
To alcohol, the cause of and solution to all of life's problems.
This tastes pretty good.
Pretty good. You know, it's a little chocolatey, but it's not too chocolatey, you know? I'm not a huge fan of like porters and like stouts or anything like that.
Yeah.
I can do a little.
It's not bad. See, reds can be kind of refreshing because they can be dark enough that you can get a full body taste, but they're not really taking over your palate.
Yeah, yeah.
And that's what I like about this beer, and I've heard mixed reviews on it.
I think the reason I like darker beers is because I don't drink coffee. I've never been a coffee guy.
You're not a coffee guy.
And it's kind of, I think they kind of have a similar taste or something. But that's not too bad.
It's a little bit coffee, but it's not too bad. That's the exact opposite of me, though. I'm a huge coffee drinker.
Yeah, no, all my friends are too, man.
Yeah,
it's like, yo, we live in Seattle.
Exactly. What we're gonna do next is we're gonna play a little game. It's called Crate Diggers, and this is how it works. Crate Diggers is a game meant for the sample pros. Here's how we play. I'm going to play a song that was sampled and made into a popular hip-hop track. Your job is to name the hip-hop track that samples the song. You will get 2 points if you can name the hip-hop song from the beginning of the sample track. You will get 1 point if you can name the song from a more obvious part of the sample track. That makes sense to you?
Yeah.
There's going to be 5 songs total, meaning you can get a total of 10 points.
Nice.
All right, let's give it a shot. They're going to get gradually harder, but here we go for the first one. Alright, we're gonna start from a part where it might be a little bit more obvious.
Okay. Oh.
He knows it now.
Operation Doomsday, MF Doom.
That's right.
Is that, don't tell me what it is. It's, is it the Blackbirds? Oh no, it's Sade.
Yep. Yeah. That's right, Kiss of Life.
Yeah.
For the actual track, just a little bit.
Yeah.
I love this track. This is my favorite MF Doom track.
Yeah, that's a great one, man.
Yeah. Okay, so you got 1 point for that one, because you got on the second try. Let's move on to song number two. And I don't know if you'll know this song, but I hope you do, because this is one of my favorite old school songs.
This is Hyro, isn't it?
Close. They're related. Let's try from the second part.
Yeah, I definitely know that sample.
You know it, okay. Maybe this will help a little bit.
Oh man. It's not Hyro, it's not Souls of Mischief.
It's Souls of Mischief.
Same thing.
Yeah, that's what I said, they're related.
It's close enough.
Yeah, I'll give you a point for that.
I don't know the name of the song.
The song is Cab Fare, which the original song is Angela, which is the theme song from Taxi.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Which I think is probably why they used, but this is a little blast from the past of the actual song.
Yo, the jam was fly. Oh my, now it's over. My batch of pals cut so tight, they must catch a taxi cab. Dagnab, why'd they leave me? Stuck in the late night app.
All right, I think you'll know this one. We'll see though. It's gonna be tough in the beginning, but here's song number three. You have 2 points so far.
Jay, is it Dilla?
Yes, yeah. Dilla.
It's one of the Donuts beats. I can't remember the name of it though.
Yeah, so far to go.
Yeah.
Yeah, with Common.
Does that count as 2 points?
That counts as 2 points. Well, let's just listen to the other part, though.
I wanna love you. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, that little bloop, bloop.
Oh,
It's really cool because that's a 6/8 beat too.
I know,
and I love it when
Dilla's so genius, man. It's just the way he chops stuff is so crazy.
It is, and the way he just used that isolated, I don't even know how you describe that part. It's not like a synth, but yeah, it's a keyboard of some sort right here. Just takes away the vocals and it makes it sound,
yeah,
so natural. So ready to go. You're up to 4 points. We're gonna go on to our fourth song right now. This one, I'll be stoked if you get this one. You don't know? All right.
Wait, hold on.
Oh, we'll switch to the second part. Okay, here you go.
Oh, man. I do know this.
I'll give you some time.
You got me, dude. I do know that is, though. I have this record. I know I do.
I'll play it for you.
Yeah. Oh, no. Yeah, this is it, yeah.
Yep. Deltron 3030. The song is 3030. This is the title track of the album. This was a huge album for me growing up.
Yeah.
I loved every song on this album. It was so weird, but I mean, it's Del, so he's just...
Del's known me too, man. My buddy Zach Hendricks is his DJ.
Really?
I met him a few times.
Oh, man. Yeah. I saw him, because I went to school in Spokane, and I saw him after Event 2 came out.
Nice.
And he played all the classics, and he played with a full-on band, and I just love that.
Yeah.
You know, when a hip-hop artist gets out there and, like, performs actual music, like you play your MPC when you perform.
Yeah.
And that's what I really enjoyed about your performance, is that you're not just up there spitting bars, you're up there actually crafting something, right?
Yeah. I originally just play beats, and I think that kind of got boring to people, so I was just sitting there twisting knobs and pushing buttons. That's why I started rapping, so there's a little bit more of a performance aspect to it. But yeah, no, I can't just, like, press spacebar on a laptop and then go rap. It's just boring.
It's super boring.
I want to, like, you know, freak it a little bit.
Exactly. And, you know, however a rapper wants to do that, if they're not the DJ, if they're not playing instruments, at least, like, I think they need a hype man up there to get people involved, you know?
Yeah.
All right, let's track to our final song of this. You're doing pretty well. You got 4 points.
4 points.
That's still pretty good.
Yeah.
That's still pretty, I mean, when you think about it, just getting it from the second option, yeah, right? When it's warped to that point where it's sampled from, that's pretty impressive.
Yeah.
Not a lot of people. This one's going to be the hardest, though, and I can barely hear this when I check this out. But let's see if you can get it.
Okay.
You'd have to really be into it to know it from that.
I know what the song is, I think, but I don't know who sampled it.
What's the song?
It's either Gladys Knight and the Pips.
No.
It's not the Stylistics. Oh, okay, maybe I'm wrong.
Think bigger. Michael Jackson.
Oh, it's the Jackson 5.
Yeah. Okay. Mm-hmm. Now let's get to the point where you might be able to identify. Yeah. If you don't, I'm not going to blame you because this is tough.
Dilla again? No. Close. Oh.
Seattle native.
It's a Seattle cat.
Yeah.
Beatmaker or like?
Beatmaker.
Do I know him? Like, do if I
I'd imagine you know him. He's pretty, I mean, he's not like in the spotlight, but he's worked with a lot of bigger people in the industry.
Jake One,
that's right. The song is Home.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, classic. Yeah.
That was off of white van music. Yeah. I remember when I was really getting Seattle hip hop, I listened to that.
Yeah, yeah. That's a classic one.
Again. Well, you did pretty good. I'm going to give it to you on that last one, though, because you still named them, even if I dropped a couple hits. That means you got 5 out of 10, which is an F. No, I'm just kidding. You did great. And I thank you for playing.
Thanks. That was fun.
Yeah, isn't it fun? Okay.
My dad and I play a game like that.
Oh, yeah?
We do a blindfold test thing. I go up and hang out at his house. He collects tons of records, too. And I'll bring a crate, and he'll have his records. And, like, we'll take turns. Like, I'll throw a record on. He's got to name who it is, or... I got to guess who it is. And if you guess, you get to, you don't get a point, but you get to be the next person to throw a record on. So if you keep not guessing it, like, you keep getting to put records on or whatever. Mm-hmm. It's pretty fun.
Yeah. Is your father into hip hop?
Yeah. Yeah. He's, you know, growing up, I listened to a lot of funk and soul and jazz because of him. Like, that's, you know, he took me, like, my first show was Bootsy Collins and, like, I went and saw Gato Barbieri and Freddie Hubbard and all these amazing jazz, funk, and soul artists because of him. And he kind of, like, set the palette for me. Mm-hmm. And then, yeah, when I was young, he, like, played me, like, Tribe, and he played me, like, Biz Markie, and just a bunch of his old cool G-Rap and, like, Big Daddy Kane. And mm-hmm. stuff. He played me all that stuff.
Yeah, so I'm sure he loves the stuff that you put out.
Yeah, yeah.
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 That's great. So, speaking of the things that you're going to come out with, you have a new project on the horizon.
Yes, I do. I just finished it last week.
Tell me about it.
What's working on it for 2.5 years.
What's it called?
It's called Shadows, and it's my first solo album, meaning a solo rap album, meaning it'll be the first album I've put out where I rap on every track, and I produce everything. Like, all my albums have mostly been production stuff. This will be my 10th release. It'll also be, yeah, my first solo rap album. And yeah, it's been like 2.5 years in the making. It's been a challenge for me because I've never, you know, I'm still kind of new to rap. I'm not that new. I've been rapping for like 4 or 5 years, but mm-hmm. it's still like I'm always a producer first. So, like, for me to write songs, it takes me a lot longer. Mm-hmm. And so it was a challenge, but it's fun because, like, you know, I put out mostly crew, and then I was like, what am I gonna do now? Like, and my manager, Hash Adams, he kind of was like, yo, you should put out a solo album. Like, he even, like, posted on Facebook, he's like, what's the next thing you want to hear from Wiz? Like, an instrumental release, another big collaboration album, or a solo album? Everybody said solo album, so I did.
Yeah.
Yeah, I named it Shadows. I named it after this John Cassavetes movie I really like a lot. All, like, it's like film noir. It was made in the 60s, and it was all, the crazy thing about it was, like, it was all improvised. Like, nothing was written. There's no script.
Sure.
Like, the whole movie was improvised. And this record was kind of like, I modeled it around kind of like the film noir, old film mobster movie kind of thing. Kind of like Mad Villain.
Okay.
It was a big, I kind of modeled it after that, and there's a lot of movie samples, and, like, it's supposed to be about me being on the run from the police, but you don't know why.
So is this a concept album?
Sort of. It's like a concept album, but it's real cinematic and stuff, and it's going to be very, it's going to sound a lot like Mad Villain. I think people will kind of get that feeling from it, but I got a lot of cool features on it, and I got to link up with Mocha Only, who's one of my favorite rappers. I grew up listening to that guy. And then my buddy Chomel from Time Machine, they're a real famous group from L.A. And I remember watching those guys on MTV when I was a kid, and now I'm, like, doing music with them. It's crazy.
Yeah.
So it's been cool, man. I got a lot of cool features on there. My man Specs One, another Seattle legend. That's who you should be interviewing right now.
Okay. Actually. Well, next show.
Next show. he's on there. It's funny. We've been friends for, like, 10 plus years, and we've never put a song out together, and finally we did a song.
Yeah.
So that's pretty cool.
So is all your features on board with this kind of noir, kind of on the run?
Yeah, well, like, there's a lot of interludes, and there's a lot of, like, skits in between stuff, and a lot of old movie samples and stuff.
That's great.
Yeah.
Where are people going to be able to listen to this?
Well, I'm planning on trying to pitch it to a couple labels, but if that doesn't happen, I'll put it out on my Bandcamp. I'll put it out solo, and I'll have it on my Bandcamp, which is wizdumb.bandcamp.com. Mm-hmm. And then it'll be on iTunes and Spotify and all that stuff. And then You can also have a CD and cassette. But the release date will definitely be mid to late August. And I'll announce that on my Facebook and Twitter and Instagram and everything.
Excellent. I look forward to that. What are you hoping people feel when they listen to Shadows?
I don't know. I mean, that's kind of for them to, decide for themselves. I hope people realize that, like, you know, I've been doing this for like 10 plus years here in the city, and like, it's about time somebody throws me a ball. But this is me being sour, man.
Yeah.
I don't know. I hope people realize that hip hop isn't dead, and I'm tired of people saying that. And I don't know. I just want, you know, people to know there's good rap music coming out of Seattle. And I feel like, you know, there's so much talent out here, and I feel like we need to be put on the map a little bit more. Because we have so much potential. Like, I think we could outshine a lot of these big cities that are, like, known for their rap. It's just, like, there's enough history here that people don't know about, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And I think, it's our turn to shine. And I'm hoping I can contribute to that somehow.
You got any big shows coming up that's going to help promote that?
This Saturday I'm throwing a cock block party for block party outside of the block party fence.
Really?
Yeah, on the street outside of Vermillion with my homies. It'll be like from 4 to 10. It'll just be like all hip hop jams.
Well, I'm hitting up Capitol Hill block party, so maybe I'll step outside and check your set.
And then I had those last two, you know, that the Crocodile, and I played at Chop Suey Friday. But I do a monthly called Pad Pushers every third Saturday, and you guys can catch me up at Vermillion doing that. And I play all the time, man. Like, I update all that stuff on my Bandcamp and Facebook and Instagram. So
is Pad Pushers an actual show, or are you just DJing in this local area?
It's a monthly beatmaker showcase.
Okay.
So it's like a... It's kind of, I pretty much started for like upcoming producers that needed to get their stuff heard. And because when I first started, I didn't really have that out here. There was Stop Biting, they put me on. But other than that, there was really no other thing for me to play at, you know. And that's kind of what I wanted to create a platform for upcoming producers, because, it makes it, you know, it easier for them to get a little bit more shine.
Bring it back. Wizdumb.
He's acting like an animal.
Taste this flavor on plastic. Memorize fragments to break the code. I cracked it. Traded in my North Face for a full metal jacket. For fashion, the rap game, Buddy Hackett. All the storytelling, telling stories of a felon. Constellations are not amazing, so go ahead and yell it. Or sell it, but keep my nuts out your mouth, black. When you steal the cheese, you get snapped like a mousetrap. Fucking house cats, y'all be sounding the same. You suckers wanna talk off the top of their lame brain. Just stutter, stutter, stutter when they're trying to say things. You need to understand what I'm trying to say. You ain't an angel, clip your wings off.
What's that?
And you ain't married to the game, slip your rings off. Y'all dudes been soft, I been off, making tracks still. Over beats to go back like pterodactyl.
Isn't he cute?
He may be cute, but he's still a dinosaur, and that makes him dangerous.
Alright, we're gonna get back to it, and we're gonna try the third and final beer from Silver City Brewery, again based in Bremerton. First, I actually have to finish my beer because
I love these can designs, man.
Yeah, they're cool. But this is the Ziggy Zoggy Summer Lager. You mentioned you were a fan of lagers and ales, so I was sure to choose this one. Give it a taste.
A woman is more like a beer. They smell good. They look good. You'd step over your own mother just to get
what
one.
Think?
It's good.
Good.
You know, it tastes like a green bottle beer. Has like a, it's like something you drink in like France or something. It's good.
Yeah, it's a little light.
You know what it tastes like? You ever had a, was that Cronenberg beer?
France?
We used to have that at Vermillion, and I used to drink that a lot. It tastes kind of like that.
Yeah.
It has kind of a little bit of a skunky taste to it.
It does. Before we start talking about hip hop in Seattle and the state of hip hop around the world, we're going to play another game.
Okay.
It's just a quick game. It's called Flip the Record. It's a simple game meant to give our listeners a glimpse on your thoughts and opinions on not just hip-hop and beer, but really anything you might know about or what we might think is fun to know. I'll give you two options. You just stay in the option you prefer. I think I already know the option to the first one, but we're going to do it anyway. RZA or MF Doom?
Doom.
PBR or Rainier?
PBR. And the reason why is because PBR uses sugar to sweeten their beer, and Rainier uses corn syrup.
I did not know that.
They taste the same.
They taste real. You see, I expect you to say Rainier because it's the Seattle thing, but I'm actually
I
with you.
Rainier too. Like, they're kind of equal. They kind of, they tie for me, but if I was going to choose one, I grew up drinking PBR.
Yeah, me too. Producer or beat maker?
Ooh, producer probably, yeah.
What do you think is the difference in your eyes?
I mean, a beat maker is like some of those backpack kids that wear these polo hats, Supreme hats, and producer is like somebody who makes a record happen, like makes the record, you know?
More cohesive.
This is somebody, like, he's the guy behind the, or guy or girl behind the, you know, the project. Like, mm-hmm. They're the DJ, the backbone, you know, of hip hop, I guess. Yeah. That's what I look at as.
Jazz or funk?
Oof. You know, if you would have asked me this when I was younger, I probably would have said jazz. Mm-hmm. I still kind of want to say jazz, but I think I'm going to say funk.
Funk is a lot of funk
lately.
All right. Whiskey or tequila?
Tequila.
Tequila, oh, all right.
Mexican, man.
Yeah. All right, how about this? GIF or JIF?
Well, I don't know. You can't. I don't know. It's a GIF, I guess.
Yeah.
Can't animate GIF. It's peanut butter.
Yeah.
GIF is what I always know it as.
Yeah, me too. All right, this is the last one. Blue Scholars or Macklemore?
Blue Scholars. Yeah. Even though I love both those guys because I grew up with those dudes. So
yeah.
So yeah.
As did I. And I ended at that one because this is what I kind of want to segue into the state of hip hop in Seattle. Back in 2012, I listened to an interview with you off your YouTube channel, and you said that the thing about Seattle hip hop is it can be clicky and fickle. Is that still something you think?
I think, I do, but I didn't mean that in a negative way when I said it. I just, like, I feel like, you know, there's this, you know, the people, there was this group called Obese Productions, and they're great and everything, and I think they're wonderful, and Melly's great, and everybody that runs it's great, but I felt like there was like this handful, just the people who put on the big hip-hop shows in Seattle, there's like just this small handful of artists that they went to put on as opening acts or promote. It was like, you know, it was like there's so much more stuff going on out here, and like you just focus on these like handful of like 6 or 7 artists, and it kind of drove me nuts, and it is kind of still like that, but I've kind of learned to accept like that's just kind of the way it's gonna be.
Yeah.
And you know, when I was younger, Wiz probably would have been a lot more militant about that, but now I'm just like, dude, I don't really care. Like, I have my audience and stuff, and I don't need other people's help to like promote my stuff. I don't think I thought that's what I needed, but I've done enough just myself, touring around by myself. But I do feel like Seattle needs to embrace more of their artists.
Yeah. Well, that was kind of the purpose of me starting this podcast, was to really try to promote artists and producers, people involved in the scene that they totally may not know yet.
Totally.
I think that's so important because, like you said before, you get annoyed with people saying that hip hop is dead, and it's so not true.
It's not.
You just need to know where to look.
I feel like, you know, this younger generation, their attention spans like that,
right?
And it's super quick, and they don't know how. I don't know. They're about convenience. Like, they're all on their phones, and they're all about just like having other things or people do things for them, I guess. And it's, you know, they're having other people make their pop culture decisions for them.
Yeah.
I guess. I don't know.
It is true what you are saying, that people have such a short attention span.
Yeah.
And, but you also think that you said this earlier, that there's nothing out there right now. And this is more on a global scale. No modern hip hop is something you dig.
Well, I don't know if I'm going to sound like a rap Nazi here, but or as like a lot of these other young people, like, oh, you're, it's like this old school boom bap sap. And I'm like, no, be like, I feel like all this new stuff is like not hip hop. I don't think it should be called hip hop.
It's pop.
It's pop, or it's, you can call it trap. That's like a new thing.
Yep.
You know, but it's definitely not, it's not, I don't think it's, you know, digging into the roots of what hip hop was about. Hip hop was about jazz and recreating and mining and discovering old stuff and giving it new life. And I feel like all this new stuff is just, I mean, there's a million producers that have like, you know, Ableton, and they just like build this preset drum pattern, and then they have some dude like rap on it or whatever they call it, the mumble thing.
Yeah.
And it's just like there's no organic substance to it. I mean, there's some good stuff, like I've heard stuff I like, but I feel like it's just been so dumbed down that it's just like boring.
Yeah.
It's like anybody can do it now.
Sure.
Like, it's not really an art form if everybody can do it.
Mm-hmm.
That's what made hip hop to me so cool, is because, like, you know, not everybody can rap and not everybody, you know, can make a fucking hot beat out of some old record or whatever. And mm-hmm. that's what made it an art form.
Right.
I feel like if everybody thinks the same, then there's like no such thing as art then. Like everybody just agrees with each other, right, and like just goes with the same thing. It's just like, oh, okay.
So what I'm hearing is there's like a huge lack of innovation.
I think we've reached this plateau of just, you know, just this convenience music or something. Mm-hmm. It's just like stuff that you can just crank out.
Sure.
And it's like, I don't know. I mean, I'm not saying I could do it. Maybe I've never really tried to make that kind of music. I don't really want to, but maybe it is tough. But it doesn't seem that tough to me. It's just like, it seems like kind of soulless and like really ignorant in a lot of ways. A lot of the stuff they talk about is like super misogynist, or like talking about drinking codeine and all this crazy shit. It's like, mm-hmm. come on, be like, that's not what's up. Like, that's what you want. Like, that's cool. Okay, that's what you want to do. I don't know. I don't understand it. I accept it, and like, I think it's, I let people like it. You know, I'm not gonna get mad at somebody for liking that stuff, but it's like, you know, why do you like it?
Yeah. So are there any, let's say outside of hip hop,
yeah,
are there any A-list or even B-list artists that you are digging on nowadays?
Well, A-list is like, what, Drake and Kanye or something?
Sure.
Hmm.
Define it as you want to.
I think I admire Kanye West's hustle and the way he, like, when he was really innovating himself. I think it's crazy how he kind of invented his own sound, like, that nobody had ever heard before in mainstream music, and everybody kind of followed him, and I think that's crazy. And I know, like, when he first started out, he was producing all these instrumentals for all these rappers that I loved in the 90s, and like some of his production back in the day was nuts.
Yeah,
I loved it.
It and, was
I'm also like, I think production wise I love Diplo. I love,
yeah,
Diplo. Everybody thinks I'm crazy. All my rap hip hop friends are like, why do you like that guy? And it's just like, I don't know, I just think he's, I like the Major Lazer shit, and I think that shit's funny. And I, you know, I'm a huge fan of like Tim and Eric Awesome Show, and they work with him a lot. They work with Diplo a lot, and I like that, yeah, shit. It's crazy and weird, and it's different, and it's dancey.
It is.
I like that footwork kind of stuff. It's cool.
Speaking of Tim and Eric, they're on Adult Swim, right?
Yeah.
And one of your beats got on to Adult Swim.
Yeah, I had three commercial bumps on there. And
How cool is that?
I only saw two of them. Apparently there was a third one that I never saw, but I was getting royalty checks for it, and I was like, what the fuck?
That's so dope, though.
I don't know how that happened, but I have this guess. Let me start from the beginning. The way I found out about that is crazy. I had this show at Lo-Fi, and about a week before, I got these royalty checks. It said for commercial, like for some commercial use stuff, and I was like, weird. I got a royalty check from BMI. You get them quarterly, and it was like a pretty good amount of money. It's like, weird, I don't remember like agreeing to anything. It's like, whatever, I'll take it. Anyway, so I'm playing a show at Lo-Fi, and this like young fan of mine shows up, and he's like, hey man, like, I'm a huge fan of your music, man. I heard you on Adult Swim. And I'm like, what? Like, what are you talking about? And he's like, yeah, dude, you didn't know? And I was like, no, I don't know what you're talking about. And then I was like, and then I thought about it. And I was like, after the show, and I was like, wait. I went up to him. He was like, I just got this royalty check from BMI. And like, maybe that's what it was. And then he went and he sent me, he recorded them on his like DVR thing and sent them to me. He's like, yeah, dude, this is you, isn't it? And I'm like, what the fuck?
That's wow. Crazy.
They put it on there like without even hitting me up. And it's cool. Like, I'm not mad about it. It's funny. The songs they picked were songs that I put out like hella long ago that I just totally don't like at all. But I guess they fit perfect for the commercial bumps.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You can't pick your fans.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, but, or the songs.
That when that happened, like, it really kind of, like, that really helped. Like, I put out Bass Mentality, my other record, right after that. And, like, that record went on to make the top 5 hip-hop albums of the year in Seattle. In the
No
Strange.
Way.
And it was because of that Adult Swim stuff.
Wow.
So I think I owe him a little bit of a thank you for that.
Sure.
Yeah.
That's excellent. Well, hey, that's about going to wrap it up for today's show. But I love that little anecdote about Adult Swim. And any last words for our listeners?
Shout out to Vermillion, Diana Adams, or Dinkus D. Shout out to Specs One, Abel Fader, Leland Jones, Zach, MF Grimm, Count Base D, Drazora Monumental, Low Fidelity Records, Dax, all the homies. And shout out to my man Kellen over here, k-rad.
Word. Oh, and one more thing, but I can't end without this because this is partially about beer. Which was your favorite out of the three?
I like the first one, I think.
The Tropic Haze?
Yeah,
me too. That shit's delicious. Hey, on your way out, stop by QFC. It's $4.50 for a six pack. Hey, I might do that. They honestly fucked up.
That's good.
Wizdumb, thank you so much for coming on the show. Again, for our listeners, that's spelled Wizdumb. You can find him on Bandcamp. You can find him on SoundCloud. And also, did you say he was on Spotify? You're on Spotify?
I'm on Spotify. I'm on Instagram. I'm on iTunes. I might have to renew that, but I'm pretty sure I'm on iTunes still. And I'm on Instagram. Yeah, if you just look up on Instagram, it's Wizdumb206. Wizdumb206. Same thing on Twitter. Same thing on Facebook. And yeah.
Give him a listen, give him a like, give him a follow. His music is absolutely great. I'm going to put those links in the description as well. Thank you, everyone, for listening to the podcast. Thank you, Wizdumb, for coming on.
Thanks for having me, man.
I'm going to play one of his new tracks on the way out. And until next time, peace.
Peace.
Get off my testicles, gassing them seas like Texaco. Gutter raps for that ass black, y'all can never test the flows. Crafting metronomes for my hood spectacles. Rumble in the city while I'm standing with the best of those. Because in retrospect, I just want respect. Busting text, maxing on the scene in the set, bet. Got my duffel and my buckle. Seas taste my knuckle, then I'm jetting with they honeysuckles. Y'all can never see me. Fuck out my peachy black, too busy salivating on these grimy three tracks. These cats bringing flavor for your relapse. Beats, raps, and green sacks. Static out of deep stats. Yo, you need to understand. Talent is dope, only blossoms in my clan, man. Damn, it's funny how we cut throats. The MasterChef duck roast.